straightforward.
All right, our next segment tonight will focus on the topic of roads and transportation. And this time, Senator Merritt, I'll start with you. You've called for express toll lanes throughout this campaign along Binford Boulevard or perhaps Fall Creek to help pay for pothole repairs. Is that a feasible plan?
It is a feasible plan. Many other cities are doing it, and number one. And two, the idea of throwing, I like working outside the box, breaking China, finding new solutions for revenue, and also allowing people to get downtown quicker and get home quicker. Many people would use a hot lane along Binford Avenue, and I think that's really, really important because we're going to have to find different ways to raise revenue, possibly from the outside counties, and that is a solid solution. I will say also that the road situation that we have is in peril. Our roads are a mess, and they have to change. We have to have somebody that knows what they're doing at the Department of Public Works. We have to have leadership from the top and not miss snows.
Mayor Hogsett, your opponent has dismissed your plan for a regional road fund, saying it doesn't have buy-in from other municipalities in our area. If that's indeed the case, what's the backup plan?
Well, let me tell you, the reason why my plan, I think, makes a lot of sense for the entire region is we do live in a day and age economically where the infrastructure of Marion County is critical to all the contiguous counties. And the one thing about my plan for our long-term regional approach, no new taxes for Marion County residents. That's just simply unacceptable. They are currently bearing the burden solely and entirely for regional infrastructure that serves all the contiguous counties. Now, Dan, I'm going to make it clear. I don't have a monopoly of good ideas. I believe that the discussion that has taken place is a very productive one. While there may not be any unanimity today, I do believe that as a region, we understand that we have to get together and come with a long-term solution. My solution is out there. Others are going to be discussed, and I look forward to that debate.
All right, Mr. McNaughton, you have suggested a program to make it easier for citizens to fill potholes on their own. Some might ask, is that taking the notion of limited government a little too far?
Well, you know, we've actually got a group, Open Source Roads, that does that now on a small scale. It started at 10th and Sherman and has expanded out as people have volunteered and offered donations for this organization, which I didn't start, but I do volunteer when I have time and take part of. And of course, you'd ask, why would you pay to fix a road you've already paid taxes to fix? Well, there's a lot of places that have been waiting on their taxes to fix their roads for quite a few years. And honestly, we've found there are instances where the roads weren't necessarily patched correctly and that they're not long-term. Now, whether this is intentional or accidental, I don't know. But we do have citizens willing to go out and work toward that effect. And I think that, again, offering that kind of outreach, that what can we do to help you help yourselves? Because the people in the neighborhoods know which roads need the most work, and rich roads can wait. Well, we don't have the budget, and more than just the city dictates.
All right, our next question is about the city's transit plan. The Red Line faced some hurdles in its first few weeks in operation, and some have criticized the creation of dedicated bus lanes. This question comes from Rachel here in Wayne Township, who wants to know, would you support shared lanes for the Blue Line when it comes to the west side so that the project doesn't negatively impact small family-owned businesses and residents that live along that route? Senator Merritt, I'll start with you.
Well, as mayor, my job is to keep Red Line clean and keep it safe. That is what the mayor's job is. Mayor Hogsett rushed the Red Line into operation, and we have congestion and we have confusion. That is hurt folks, constituents, businesses along College Avenue. And we can't repeat that with the Blue Line. We have to have an accountable, a transparent, and accessible process when we're developing the ideas for the Blue Line. That is incredibly important, and that's what I will do as mayor.
Mayor Hogsett, your response.
Yeah, I've actually had several conversations with Rachel about this very issue. And the Red Line just reported this morning having enjoyed 230,000 passengers in the month of September alone. Most importantly, ridership generally throughout the county has been up 30% in that same period of time. So I'm optimistic about the Red Line. It was not rushed. It's been successful. 230,000 riders is not what I would call empty. So as we think about the Purple Line and the Blue Line, I do think that we need to learn lessons from the design and the construction of the Red Line and apply those lessons, whether it's lessons regarding Rachel's question about dedicated lanes or something else. We need to apply those lessons as we propose and construct the Purple and Blue Lines and make sure we don't make the same mistakes twice.
Mr. McNaughton, your thoughts?
Well, of course, we have been saying Red Line deadline for since it started. It's an obsolete concept that's based on an interurban project that's 100 years old now, and the city is simply not built for a point-to-point transportation. That's not laid out that way, and it is something that will struggle going forward. Now, my initial proposal would be to put a halt or at least a break on future construction until we figure out how to make the Red Line work effectively, because it's already here, there's no doubt about that. There's no throwing out the baby with the bathwater. However, I would propose we get private enterprise more involved with our public transportation for more 21st century solutions. There are cities, despite the fact that I've heard otherwise from people in other cities, but there are cities in this country that have a bus system that is run completely privately with the city only dictating routes and stops, and we already have a hub at the Julian Carson Center, so we're already halfway there.
All right, our next question is also from a viewer. It comes from Phil in downtown Indianapolis, who wants to know, if elected or reelected mayor, will your administration enforce the laws for scooter riders? Senator Merritt.
Thank you, Phil. It is very important that we do enforce laws for scooter use. I think it's a very good idea, though, that we look at other cities and best practices of actually a safe city in regards to scooters. I've had many people who have talked to me about actually have scooters laying down in the middle of a sidewalk and someone in a wheelchair can't get by. There are a lot of problems with people riding scooters around the city, and it's very, very, very important that we have collaboration and communication with all the residents of the downtown area.
Mayor Hawkshead.
Well, on this topic, Senator Merritt and I are in agreement. I think that the scooters have been yet another option for personal mobility, and they are here in full force. But the public's pathways need to stay clear. Riders need to be reminded of where they are allowed to have the scooters and not. And so enforcement of that, I think, is critically important to safety of pedestrians as well as the scooter riders. But it's a much broader question of personal mobility. I mean, it's not just scooters, it's more bike lanes. It's opportunities to travel from point A to point B in ways that we've never thought of before. Pedestrian traffic, and obviously the bus. And I'm very pleased to have joined the Personal Mobility Network in the private sector downtown so that we can have these discussions about 21st century transportation.
Mr. McDonald.
I actually love the scooters. That's a great idea. The city didn't propose it. The city didn't create it. The city didn't buy the scooters. We had private companies come in with their money, their investment. They bring the scooters, and this is one of the legitimate jobs of government, even from a libertarian point of view, to regulate the industry that's in our city. So yeah, we do need to adjust ordinances and make sure that the people who are running the scooters do so in a way that's helpful and not hurtful to our city.
All right, next we want